بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد إن شاء الله today will be the part 3 of the etiquettes of dressing and clothing and with that inshallah we'll finish the subject by the will of Allah. So we have talked about the sunnah when it comes to wearing clothes and how this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had honored the son of Adam with. And then when it comes to the garment and what is the way to wear it and how low should it go. And we talked about the izar and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibiting having the clothes below the ankle bone. And then we talked about the clothing of the woman and how this is something that has to be according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered and the great warning that came in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about those who would go out and be a reason for the fitna for themselves and for others when they are not abiding by the Islamic hijab. We talked about the prohibition of wearing gold and silk for the men of this ummah and how they are halal for the women of this ummah. And lastly, we talked about how important in our deen is to for the one to be very careful about the neatness and the cleanliness of his clothing and how yani, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directed his sahaba that if someone has a wealth, that it should reflect on the way he dresses and the one should show the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously without having the arrogance. The next thing that we'll talk about inshallah is what to say if someone wears something that is new. So he says, ما يقوله إذا لبس ثوبا جديدا ونحوه. عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا استجد ثوبا سماه باسمه إما قميصا أو عمامة ثم يقول اللهم لك الحمد أنت كسوتني أسألك من خيره وخير ما صنع له وأعوذ بك من شره وشر ما صنع له. قال أبو نضرة فكان أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا لبس أحدهم ثوبا جديدا قيل له تبلي ويخلف الله تعالى. أخرجه أبو داود والترمذي والحديث صحيح. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, if he has a new thawb, then he would call it with its name, either, you know, a qamis, like the thawb, or a imama, something that he wears on his head sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he would say, Allahumma laka alhamd, O Allah, praise be to you, anta kasawtani, you are the one who made me wear it. أسألك من خيره وخير ما صنع له. I ask you from its goodness and the goodness from for which it was made, right? Because someone might, you know, wear something and go for it with something haram, or for example, wear a shoe and go take the steps with this shoe to something haram, right? But at the same time, he can use it to cover his awra and come to the masjid and do something that is lawful, right? Walk in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that I ask you from its goodness and the goodness for which it was made. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّهِ وَشَرِّ مَا صُنِعَ لَهُ. And I seek refuge in you from its evil and the evil for which it was made. So Abu Nadra, he said, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, if some of them would wear something clothes, some clothing that is new, they would make a dua for him and they would say to him, Tubli wa yukhlifu Allahu ta'ala. That Tubli meaning that you would wear it until it's worn out, you know, and you need something else. Wa yukhlifu Allahu ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaces. Right? So the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is again, اللهم لك الحمد وأنت كسوتني. Knowing the ni'mah of Allah, that He is the one who had given it to the one. It's not just because of your earning, but because you are able to go to the mall or buy it online or whatever, and you had the means. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that had the favor on you, that He had given you this life, just like He gave you all the other ni'am, right? So the one remembers that. And the one asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from its goodness and seeks refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil it was created for. وعن أم خالد بنت خالد قالت أتي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بثياب فيها خميصة سوداء فقال من ترون تكسوها هذه الخميصة فأسكت القوم فقال إيتوني بأم خالد فأتي بي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فألبسنيها بيده وقال أبلي وأخلقي مرتين أخرجه البخاري. Umm Khalid, she said that once the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was brought some clothing, and among those clothing there was like a black clothing for a woman. And he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who do you think, yani this khamisa, this clothing, this black clothing should be wearing it? And she said, the people kept silent. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, bring to me Khalid. So Khalid was brought to him, and he sallallahu alayhi wasallam put it on her and made a dua for her and said, abli wa akhliqi. Abli wa akhliqi marratain, twice. Narrated by Imam al-Bukhari. Same thing with making a dua with the one so that he would wear it, and something that will be later on replaced, meaning for something to stay with the one and to use it and get the benefit of it, and then get to a point where he would just need something else, and for the one to live a longer life in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the great ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the best of the people is the one who would live for a longer life, but not only that, longer life with good actions. And of course, this makes sense. Why? Because it is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ to start with, but also, if the one lives longer, he is earning more for the matters of the hereafter. Now about the shoe and the wearing of the foot. There are some ahadith in that regard. عن جابر رضي الله عنه قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في غزوة غزوناها استكثروا من النعال فإن الرجل لا يزال راكبا من تعل أخرجه مسلم. جابر, may Allah please with him, he said, I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying in one of the journeys that we were with, استكثروا من النعال, that use a lot of the ni'al, meaning the shoes. At the time, many of the Sahaba used to be barefooted, right? And not necessarily have the luxury of having shoe wear, like footwear, like shoes and stuff. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, استكثروا من النعال. If the one can afford it, then this is good to have alternatives. And nowadays, if the one can have like different pairs of shoes, this is good. Right, especially when it is needed, when they are like traveling. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the reasoning with that. He said, فَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَا يَزَالُ رَاكِبًا مَنْ تَعَلْ, that the man would continue to be as if he is riding when he is putting shoes on. Right, the ulama talked about it. Right, we said that not of all of them used to have shoes. And this was the way they lived. But they were the best of the generations that came among this ummah, right? And then not all of them, when they traveled with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, used to be able to have an animal to ride. Many of them had to walk. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying that as long as the one is wearing a shoe or a ni'al, footwear, then he is like if he is riding. The ulama talked about it, and they said that because of the easiness that it gives him, right? And the easiness and the fastness that he can travel with, as if he is someone who is riding. When you compare someone who has something that he's wearing in his foot and someone who is not. And that's why the ulama even now talk about the fact that it is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to have multiple pairs. And this is something that by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nowadays most people do have it, right? You have, you know, a shoe, you have a slipper, you have a running shoe, something like that, different footwear. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا انتعل أحدكم فليبدأ باليمين وإذا انتزع فليبدأ بالشمال لتكن اليمنى أولهما تنعل وآخرهما تنزع متفق عليه. In the hadith narrated by al-Bukhari and Muslim, Abu Huraira, may Allah please with him, he said that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said that if some of you انتعل, meaning put his shoe on, then let him start with the right. Let him start with the right. And if he takes his shoe off, then let him start with the left. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لِتَكُنُ الْيُمْنَ أَوَّلَهُمَا تُنْعَلْ. Make the right always the first one to be covered with the shoe, and the last one to be uncovered with the shoe for the right. Right? So the one again starts with the right and then puts the left. And if he wants to take them off, he starts with the left and then take the right. So this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It comes with the fact that in our deen, if you look at it in general, it honors the right. Right? And for something to be covered, this is a way of honoring. Right? Again, going to what we talked about at the beginning. So when we cover it first, it's from honoring it. And when we uncover it last, then it's a way of honoring so that it would stay for a longer time that is covered. Right? So, and this is something that should not be taken lightly. Right? Something that we should take in the habit. Why? If we say, someone can come and say, well, what's the importance of that? Then the answer is, why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talk about it? Yani, did he talk about something that is not important just because, you know, he wants to talk about something? Ma'ad Allah. No, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when it comes to things that are small in our life, we think they are small, they are from the sunnah. Anything from the sunnah is not small. Right? It's something that has a significance to it. Right? And maybe by those small things that we see as small, right, if we get the habit of using them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide us to do the bigger things that we need to do. Right? So no one should take these things lightly. Teach your kids how to do it. If this is the way they do it since they are young, then it becomes a habit, it's natural. They don't even have to think about it when they do it. Right? The problem is that when we neglect things until it's difficult to add things. Another thing that is not mentioned here is that it is disliked for someone to have one foot covered and the other not covered. So either you cover both or you uncover both. And it happens sometimes you take one off and leave the other one on for whatever reason. But this is something that is disliked, and the one should try to avoid that. Then he said, "Ma warada fi khawatim al-rijali wa ayna tulbas?" What has been reported in the rings that men wear and wear to wear them. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه نهى عن خاتم الذهب. متفق عليه. Abu Huraira, may Allah please with him, he said that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he prohibited the ring of made of gold, narrated by Bukhari Muslim, something that we talked about. And we're just repeating it because it is something that is repeated here with each category. So we talked about this. وعن أنس رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان خاتمه من فضة وكان فصه منه. أخرجه البخاري. Anas, may Allah please with him, he said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his ring used to be of silver, وَكَانَ فَصُّهُ مِنْهُ, and its fas, meaning the fas is, you know, the part of the ring that is protuberant or something that is coming out, right? It can be from a colored stone, different type of stone, you know, sometimes it's brown, sometimes it's blue, the way the rings are. And this hadith says that the fas, this fas is part of it, right? There is another hadith, it will come with us, that the fas is habashi, right? It's from the Habasha. Usually they used to bring the, like those, you know, those colored stones and stuff like that up until, and still now, like Africa, the continent of Africa is very rich with it, right? So you'll find that they used to bring it from there. So the next hadith, Anas bin Malik himself, the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is saying that the Messenger of Allah labisa khatama fiddatin fi yaminih fihi fassun habashi kana yaj'alu fassahu mimma yali kaffah. Akhrajahu Muslim. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Anas reported in this other hadith narrated by Muslim, he said that he wore a silver ring in his right. So this is like further description. فِيهِ فَصٌ حَبَشِي. This part that is protuberant is a stone from Al-Habasha. كَانَ يَجْعَلُ فَصَّهُ مِمَّا يَلِي كَفَّهُ. And he used to make this fass, meaning this protuberant part, like turned so that it is on the side of his palm, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And let's take the next hadith inshallah, and then we'll talk about them all together. وعن أنس رضي الله عنه قال, Anas, may Allah peace with him, he also said, صنع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خاتما. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made a ring. قال, إن اتخذنا, then he said صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن اتخذنا خاتما ونقشنا فيه نقشا فلا ينقش عليه أحد. That we have made a ring, and we had engraved on it some engraving, and we'll talk about this, so no one should engrave on it. طيب. قال, then Anas said, فإني لأرى بريقه في خنصره. So I see the reflection of this silver ring in his khunsur. The khunsur here, this is the khunsur, the ring finger, okay? So he said, I saw it. So this hadith was narrated by Bukhari. So to talk collectively about the rings, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, at one stage in his da'wah, he started writing letters for the kings and the rulers of the nations around him, for Kisra, the king of Persia, to the Romans and all these things. And he was told, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that those kings would not accept a letter except that if it has a stamping. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made this ring, and it was engraved on it, Muhammadun Rasulullah. So the engraving that is mentioned here, what it was Muhammadun Rasulullah, Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah. And he used sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to stamp with it. Right? So, to take the last hadith for example, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that we had made a ring and engraved something on it, so no one should engrave on it. What is meant by that is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited people to engrave on it what he engraved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is mentioned in other hadith. Right? So people, what happened is that they used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in everything. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam engraved on it this, they engraved on it the same thing. To follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are a hadith also that came that mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took a ring and then he took it away and threw it. And the people immediately followed him and they took the ring away and they threw it away. It was mentioned that this was a ring of gold that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam initially took, and then it was prohibited and he took it off and the people took it off. Or it was explained also as this incident when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam initially had this engraving, he saw the people doing the same thing, he prohibited them, he took it off sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people took it off, and then when it happened that people no longer had this same engraving, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took it back. And he used it. And this was, as also narrated in Al-Bukhari, the ring that has the engraving of Muhammadun Rasulullah that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to wear when he was alive. And after him, Abu Bakr, he was be the one who used to wear it. And then it was in the hand of Umar ibn al-Khattab, he used to wear it. And then it was in the hand of Uthman bin Affan, who used to wear it. And then it was in the hand of who? No. No, it was lost. It was lost when Uthman bin Affan, he lost it in the Bi'r of Aris. When he lost it in the well of that had, its name is Aris, right? So he lost it there. And this was how, the ending of like this ring being worn by different successors of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. So to take them collectively, it is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. So for someone to wear a ring, this is from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the one takes it as such, he wants to imitate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he can follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like with the details. So he can wear it in the right, he can wear it in the left. It was mentioned he used to wear it in the right. So this is like a closer imitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The fas, the protuberant part, it can be like from a colored stone or part of the ring itself, and the one can sometimes flip it and put it on his palm side to imitate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And sometimes he can twist it to the other side. He can wear it in like different fingers, but to wear it in the khunsur, this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. And it's a matter of, having the love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and imitating him. You see people, and to Allah and His Messenger is of course the best example. If someone likes, nowadays a singer, he would imitate him with his haircut. He would imitate him with everything, right? If you see like a soccer player, you will find that people would imitate him like in the details, right? In the way they walk, in the way they clothe and all these things. And why is it, someone might find that it is, exaggeration to mention all these things about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The man, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, will be gathered on the Day of Judgment with the people that he loves. And a way of reflecting this love is that you imitate the one. Now, especially that it is not only just a love that you are imitating the one for. No, this is a ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the one imitates the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, before we leave this subject, just to talk briefly about, when we talk about rings, we have to talk about the wedding rings. Right? And we have to mention that this is something that is not in our deen. It is not in our deen to have a marriage or a wedding ring. But rather, this is something that is an imitation of the non-Muslims. And imitating the non-Muslims is something that is prohibited in our deen. طيب. Now, this is in general. If there is a habit that is a habit of nations other than the Muslims, then we should not imitate it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man tashabbaha biqawmin fahuwa minhum." Or kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam, "Whoever resembles people, then he's among them. He's one of them." Right? But rather, the resemblance should be for the believers and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to start with. Right? Now, this is a prohibition in general. Now, if something has a religious origin other than the religion of the Islam, then this is definitely a falsehood. And this is a stronger reason not to do it. So if something did not have religious basis, طيب, from the nations of others than Muslims, then we should not do it anyways. And if it has a religious background, then it's even a stronger prohibition to do it. And when it comes to the wedding finger, just so that we know, it has an origin in Christianity. And the origin of it is that they, like the priests, maybe they don't do it nowadays when they do it, but this is the origin of it. They used to, when the priest would, make the marriage, when they, like the man and the woman would come in front of the priest, and he will pronounce, like will announce them as a husband and a wife, at that moment they usually put the ring, and usually the way they do it, they say with the Father, with the soul, and with the Holy Spirit, or the Son, or the Trinity combination, they would mention it and put the ring. This is the way it originated. So What I'm trying to say, it has an origin in the deen of the Nasara that has shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for someone to come and imitate in such a thing, this is something that the one should be totally away from. You know, for someone to say, well, how would I be known that I am married? Well, who should, do you have to walk on the streets and people point at you and say that this man is married and this is not? No, right? But rather, this is something that the one should stay away from. But again, not to misunderstand that, thinking that this is like wearing a ring is something that's not part of our deen. No, it's part of our deen, but it's not for the specific reason of the marriage. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما شهدت العيد مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فصلى قبل الخطبة فأتى النساء فجعلنا يلقين الفتخ والخواتيم في ثوب بلال متفق عليه. Some like couple of hadith that mention what among the jewelries of the women that are permitted. The hadith of Abdullah bin Abbas that is narrated by al-Bukhari and Muslim, where he said that I witnessed the Eid prayer with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he said فصلى قبل الخطبة, and he prayed before the khutbah. We know this is the way the Eid prayer is, right? The Eid prayer, we pray before the khutbah, different from the way the Jumu'ah is, right? Then he said فأتى النساء, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to the woman فجعلنا يلقين الفتخ والخواتيم في ثوب بلال. Then he said that they started giving in charity al-fatakh. Al-fatakh, it was described, the meaning of it is that the rings that are huge, you know, like very big and prominent, right? Those are al-fatakh, and al-khawatim, the smaller rings, they used to throw it in the thawb of Bilal. He used to hold his thawb so that people would give charity in the cause of Allah. Now, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is actually part of the sunnah, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give the khutab, especially in the Eid, he used to, in part of the khutbah, address the woman and give advices that are specific for the woman. And this is something that we often neglect. We know that it's from the sunnah of the Eid prayer is that the household should come to it, because this is one of the celebrations for the Ummah, right? There's only two celebrations when it comes to Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. And the one should have the habit of bringing the household, right? Bringing the wife, bringing the daughters, bringing the kids, all of them should come, even to the extent that at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, even women who have the period where they cannot pray, they would come and attend the ceremony of the Eid, not necessarily pray with those who pray, right? But would come and attend, and this is part of it. Right, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used in the Eid to address the women specifically, reminding them with fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their duties in their homes and all these things. And among the things is that he used to encourage them to give in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Giving in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving charity, is not something that is restrictive to the men, but even the women might have wealth and positions that they can give for the cause of Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to address them, advise them, and would encourage them to spend in the cause of Allah. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is something that even men can learn from, he used to say to the woman, he said to Asma, أنفقي أو أعطي ولا تحصي فيحصي الله عليك, that give and do not count what you are giving, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not count how much reward He will give you, meaning He will give you countless rewards. You know, when you open your wallet and you see, you have $100, you count 20, 40, no, I need those 20, 40, but rather close your eyes, put your hand over it, take everything and give it in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of أحصي ولا تحصي فيحصي الله عليك, that do not give and do not count so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you in a countless way, just like you had given countlessly in the cause of Allah. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها, there are only three hadith that are left. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها استعارت من أسماء قلادة فهلكت فبعث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا فوجدها فأدركتهم الصلاة وليس معهم ماء فصلوا فشكوا ذلك إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأنزل الله آية التيمم. Aisha, may Allah pleased with her, she narrated that she borrowed a necklace from Asma. Asma bint Abi Bakr, right? So she borrowed a necklace from Asma, فهلكت, meaning it was lost. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he sent a man to look for it and he found it. And because of that, they were delayed. And the time of the salah came on them. I think they were on a journey. I'm not sure, but I think they were on a journey at that point. So the time of the salah came and they did not have water supplies. They, like the water supply that with them were out. Then they complained to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he revealed the ayah of at-tayammum. He revealed the ayah of at-tayammum for the one to make tayammum if he did not have the water. Right, and this hadith was narrated by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. The relationship of this hadith to the subject that we are talking about is that, like the ulama said, that they said fihi mashru'iyyat wa jawaz 'ariyat al-huli, that it is allowed in our deen that people would borrow necklaces and jewelries, and there is nothing wrong with that. And also one of the benefits is that it is something that is allowed, that if someone borrows something, that it's allowed for him, it's permissible for him to travel with it as long as it was with the permission from the one who had lent it for him, right? And this is in general, right? If you borrow something, then it is not yours, you are borrowing it, you have to take the permission if you are about to do something different from what the norms are, right? Like for example, traveling. Likewise, for example, if you are someone who had borrowed money, right, from someone, took a loan, and you want to, for example, go for Umrah or go for Hajj or do something before paying back, the priority is for paying back. But if you go to the man and say, you know, brother, Jazakallahu khairan, you had like lent me the money, and I know that the priority is to give you back your money, but I have this opportunity that I can invest in, or I have this chance to go for Hajj and I might not be able to. Do you allow me to do it and then I'll pay you later on? This is the way it should be. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, مَطْلُ الْغَنِيِّ ظُلْمٍ, for the one to be able to pay back, and the time had come for paying back, and you have the ability to do it, but you don't pay it, then this is ظُلْم, transgression, right? To say, well, I will not pay back until I like buy a car, until I, for example, finish my furnishing my home, until I do this or this or that. No, it is not something that is allowed. Right, but rather the one can take the permission, and if he is allowed, he can do it. Last two hadith when it comes to the humbleness, when it comes to wearing the clothing that we wear and the sleeping pads that we take. عن أبي بردة رضي الله عنه قال, Abu Barda, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, he said, أخرجت إلينا عائشة كساء وإزارا غليظا فقالت قبض روح النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذين. He said, Abu Barda, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, Aisha brought out to us a kisa and wa'izar, like an upper and lower garments, upper body and lower body garments, that was very thick. And she said, رضي الله عنها, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم died in those. And his soul was taken out while he was wearing those, right? And this was the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, right? And it was not a matter of the dunya. Again, there's no contradiction between that and what we have mentioned in the past about showing the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if this is what the one can afford, alhamdulillah, it's good, right? And it is not about, you know, and having the focus on what you wear and having this in your heart rather than something that you use if you had. There are many hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he used to wear, and I think we mentioned them, like nice clothing with different colors that we used to be brought to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died with those. The last hadith, the hadith of Aisha, may Allah please with her, she said, إنما كان فراش رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الذي ينام عليه أدما حشوه ليف. أخرجه مسلم. Aisha said that the bedding of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم that he used to sleep upon used to be made of animal skin that was filled with leaf. Leaf is what is the leaf? It's leaf? Leaf. No, not grass. Leaf is, you know, the thing is, you know, nowadays, like the thing that you wash your body with when you take a bath is very soft. But, you know, in the older days, they used to be like the thick stuff that like, rubs the skin really well. What is that called? Leaf? Huh? Not a sponge. Sponge is soft, but something that is... But you understand what? Something that is, you know, hard, right? Hard. And this was the what this skin that he used to sleep on, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was like filled with, right? And we know, you know, the hadith of Umar ibn Khattab when he came and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sleeping on the side, and there were the marks of this like bedding of him on his side, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Umar, he wept. He cried and he said, O Prophet of Allah, you are the messenger of Allah, and this is Kisra in his kingdom, the king of Persia, and this is, you know, Qaisar, the king of the Roman, and the place is having all the, you know, the luxury and all this. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that those are people who are like their goodness have been hastened to them, so that they are already utilized it. But this is not what the Muslim is looking for. Again, this is not a prohibition for the one to have comfortable bedding and all these things. But again, like we mentioned with the wealth, to have it in your hand, not in your heart. Meaning, if you have it, alhamdulillah, I use it. And I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. If I don't have it, I'm not miserable and I cannot live. But rather, alhamdulillah, I'm content because the dunya is not the goal. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.